see y'all here this morning. As we come together as a church congregation, today is a very big day. However, it is a day that perhaps for many will go down in infamy. It's a day that we remember a tragic event that took place in our nation on this very day, 9/11. And so, before we begin with our festivities to celebrate the ministry of the church and what we've done, we do have a video that we would like to play just as a tribute to what has happened in our nation and the brave men and women that have fought to give us freedom, but also to those who tragically lost their lives on 9/11. Emily?
We have a very tragic alert for you right now. An incredible plane crash into the World Trade Center here at the lower tip of Manhattan.
When the night seems to
sleep, a massive gaping hole.
All is lost. Gone away. She
There was a period after that tragic event in which for one moment, across belief systems and minds, we were one nation. Since then, we have seen division, difficulty, heartache, and pain. Perhaps maybe some have forgotten. I pray that no one here has. Today is a day of difficulty for many of you because you remember those events. But today is also a day for celebration. Cedar Grove Christian Church, the building in which you are currently sitting, has stood as an example of the gospel, the love of Christ, and hope, even in the face of adversity, such as the events that transpired on 9/11. This church has stood since 1884 to proclaim the love and the hope found in Christ. But even before this building in which you are sitting, erected in 1884, 10 years prior, in 1874, the first group that would call themselves Cedar Grove Christian Church met together. For 148 years, this church has shared the gospel and the love of Jesus Christ. When we look at what transpired on 9/11 in 2001, yes, there was a great loss of life, there was difficulty and heartache, but there was also a revival that took place in this nation as people turned to God. This church was here with doors open, arms open, hearts open, to receive, to share, and to love. As we come together today, we have to remember the tragedies and the adversities that we've experienced, but we also come together to celebrate the joy and the love that we share. So this morning, as we remember this church's history, we're going to do something a little different. Last week I announced, sarcastically so, as if you don't know me very well, you'll find I'm very sarcastic, that it was going to be Stump the Piano Player Day. We're going to be doing a Singspiration this morning. We're going to have a couple of songs and then partake of the Lord's Supper together and return to our tithes and offering and pastoral prayer. And then you, brothers and sisters, are going to direct the service. You are going to get to pick the songs that we sing this morning. I do invite you to pick the ones that are dear to your heart. We do request, however, that if it is one that people do not know, that you be willing to help lead it. Okay? As we turn our attention towards worship, I want to read Psalm 65, verse 4. Blessed are those, Lord, who you choose to bring near to live in your courts. We are filled with the good things of your holy temple. As we gather together this morning, there's an opportunity for us to worship our Lord, to celebrate all that he has done for us. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, our lives are busy. In the midst of busyness, we stop to worship you. It is in you that we find our purpose in this world. Our lives are worthwhile because we know you. Plan our days to change lives. Help us to keep our time in perspective as we trust you daily. Use us as a group, as a congregation, as a church family that people can turn to in time of need. As a congregation which people can turn to receive the love of Christ. As a congregation that will boldly preach and proclaim the truth of the gospel message. As we sing these songs this morning, may they be a joyful noise to your ear. For you alone are worthy of praise. In Jesus' holy and precious name, amen. Bye.
like to follow along? I apologize. One of these days we'll figure this out and I'll actually get slides that look good up there. We can all see. Our first hymn, if you follow along, is Victory in Jesus, 499.
Thank you. Have you ever noticed how sometimes when you least expect it, a smell, a sound, a sight reminds you of something else? You've made that association with that smell or sound. For me, it's music. I can hear a song and I can remember where I was driving or sitting when I heard that song 40 years ago. That association is so strong in my mind. Sometimes there are people in our life that we just can't wait to see. We just have that association with them. And then sometimes there's those people we just can't wait to get away from because they have a different association in our mind. Some of us, you probably heard the old cliche, just like riding a bike, once you learn, you never forget. Now some of us might challenge that, but you wonder, what is that association? And this last week I was listening to the radio and I heard somebody talking about neurons that fire together, wire together. Now, I'm sure everybody knows what a neuron is. That's in your brain. It's the connection. It's the electrical connections in your brain. And as we fire those electrical connections, several of them that are close together tend to start to share common pathways. And that's why we associate certain things with certain activities. And I got to thinking about that, and it's like they gave credit to a neuropsychologist by the name of Head that wrote that little thing about neurons that fire together, wire together. And that was new and different back then. But I thought, that is actually a biblical principle. Jesus talked about those kind of things way back when. In 1 Corinthians 11th chapter, verse 23, and you're all familiar with this. Paul says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This is the cup of the new covenant of blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you're proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes.'" So Jesus was telling the disciples, whenever you eat, whenever you drink, think about me. Make those associations in your mind. Jesus is telling them to take ordinary, everyday events and make them extraordinary because of the way we associate them. I also like to think, we think we're real smart nowadays, and we quote these guys that do all this sorts of research. But Jesus was sitting at the table with his disciples. Jesus, the man who made those disciples, who created them, who created this pathway, who created their mind. And he's trying to explain to them how to do this. He can't explain how it works, but all he can do is explain, this is the way I made you. Use the tools I gave you so that as we move on, it makes your life easier. You can remember, you can associate what I need you to remember. Will you bow?
Father God, as we come around your table this morning, remember what Jesus did on the cross. As we take the bread, help us to remember and to associate that it reminds us of the body of Christ as he lived the perfect life and then he hung on the cross as he was taking our place. In your name we pray.
Our Heavenly Father, as we take the cup that represents the blood that was shed, Father, help us to make the associations. Help us to take the ordinary and make it extraordinary because of what you did. Father, as we take this time to remember the perfect sacrifice, the perfect lamb that was given in our place to redeem us, to save us from our own sins, from our own certain death, and give us the hope of life everlasting. And we pray all of this in your Son's name.
Inside flap where it says prayers and praises. any updates?
Well, I have an update. Casey Todd, who is on our immune cancer section, she's a co-worker of mine, and she has finished her all of her rounds of treatment, and she just had her PET scan, and she is cancer-free. So it's a wonderful blessing for her and her family, and something that has been a huge praise for them, and something that they want to thank everyone for their prayers.
Okay, so praise for the good news from our friend. Frida's brother with the Amish buggy that ran into him on his motorcycle. I guess he was going around the curve. We know more about it now. He was going around a curve on a gravel road, and the horse was taking the wrong side of the road and ran into him. But he's doing better, so praise for that. Also, I would say a praise for those of us who got some rain yesterday. We needed the rain. Any other updates?
Yeah, we got praise yesterday. Little Millie showed up. She wasn't supposed to be here until the 23rd, but she came yesterday. She weighed, what, 6 pounds, 3 ounces? She's this long. But Jacob McKenzie's little one.
So. All right, so that's, there's a praise. Yeah, I was going to mention that, Asher. I've seen yesterday, I think, or a day ago, they were asking for more prayers because it took a little turn for the worse, but I haven't heard any this is Asher used to go here, but Luke had the baby was born at 24 weeks, so it's getting like 1.8 pounds, and so continued prayers with that in the ICU. I heard that it took a little turn for the word, but I hadn't heard anything.
He gives it a blood transfusion. Yeah. And then it's like a fluid as well.
Yeah.
So they could go in there and try to keep their all this money.
So continue prayers for the little baby. Any other updates or new prayer requests?
I don't know. Tell you what, I'm glad I'm feeling better. The way it's incredible. It just gets you like a ton of bruises.
Grace Sherry's feeling better.
This is the whole week of work, which I was all right. It's like I had a week off and didn't feel like doing nothing.
Yeah, that's always bad.
Like the old fashioned flu, just I didn't think I had in years.
Obviously, remembering our tribute to 9/11, there's a lot of people that died that day, and since then, a lot of soldiers have died, you know, as a result of that, defending our country. So we want to remember them and pray for them. Any others? If not, before we pray, my thought, in James, there's a scripture that says the prayer of a righteous man or woman availeth much. In other words, it's powerful. What he's trying to say. And I always thought, you know, wouldn't we all want to have powerful prayers? And one way is being righteous. But obviously, you know, what's that mean? What's that really look like? 1 Peter chapter 3 has, I want to read a passage. He says, "Finally, all of you, be like-minded, be sympathetic, love one another, be compassionate and humble. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult. On the contrary, repay evil with blessing, because this is what you were called so that you may inherit a blessing. For whoever would love life and see good days must keep their tongue from evil and their lips from deceitful speech. They must turn from evil and do good. They must seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. For who is going to harm you if you're eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you're blessed." So, you know, we all know we're not perfect people. But with the help of God, if you're a Christian, you've been given a new nature. And if we allow God's Spirit to work in us, we can be different. We can repay evil with good. We can be sympathetic. We can love one another. We can be compassionate. In other words, and people are going to notice that. But God's going to notice it too. And it will make our prayers even more powerful. So let's pray. Father, we want to lift up those on our list. It's always long, because we live in this fallen world. But Lord, we know that you know who's on this list, that you know the situations. We know that we can trust you. We know we can trust you even when what we want isn't what always happens. But we can trust that you are in control. And we pray, Lord, that you would help us to strive to be righteous people, good people, people that represent you well. And when we are, we know that you hear our prayers. In your name we pray. Amen.
Inspiration. Growing up as a kid, it was the highlight of my quarter or year, however long it took us to have one. It was always the highlight, and we never got bored as kids because we really did play Stump the Piano Player and Stump the Music Leader. Can we sing this one? Well, you can come and sing it. We muddled through. If you have a song, call her out, raise your hand, let me know. Harvey.
601.
601.
You're still in the thunder for later, Harvey.
That's all right. 601. We'll sing it anyway. I like it. Don't be shy. If you need to clap, this one's one of those clapping songs.
Thank you.
singing it along, whether in the car or home or wherever. Was it Burton's Fifth Street?
Thank you. Thank you.
decides to take off and run with it.
230?
230. Yeah. The old running cross.
Oh, that's a good one. You might need a Kleenex for a different reason after this one. 230, the old rugged cross. We'll sing verses 1 and 4.
Thank you.
And growing up, I had it on both sides of the family that we sang. Just about anywhere we went, we sang. If it wasn't in the car, it was at home. My grandma Goosey, she wanted to feel like the kids would, grandkids would continue to need her after we got older, because she felt like we'd grow up and we'd move on and we wouldn't need grandma anymore. And so she taught herself to play all of these instruments, folk instruments. She played a dulcimer, she played a spoon, she played a washtub bass, she played a violin, she played a mandolin. She learned one for each of the grandkids. We had a whole band, and we would go from church to church and we'd sing. And sometimes Grandma would just show up on a Sunday night and be walking in with our instruments. We never knew whether we were singing or not. And we'd come in and Grandma would go, well, we did practice that earlier this week. Remember, we pulled this one out of the back of the book. And sure enough, we had practiced that one. And sure enough, preacher already knew we were singing, and the whole congregation knew we were singing, but we didn't know we were singing. And, you know, and that's kind of some of those bonds. You know, Clyde was talking about the neurons that fire together, they wire together. We had a whole lot of memories where us grandkids were very connected to Grandma. She created a way for us to build bonds that would never be broken down. And some of the songs we learned, some of the songs we went and sang, she took all 12 of us younger grandkids and put us all in 1970s Ford RV that had the over-the-cab bunk and the couch that let down and the table that let down. And she packed 12 grandchildren and my grandparents in this vehicle, took us all to Iowa. And for a weekend, no parents. I still don't know how she did it. They parked right next to the playground, and if it wasn't raining, we were outside. But in that, we went from jam session to jam session, and we would play and we would sing. And it's been, you know, one of those memories that forever has stuck with me. And it's something that created a family bond. So other than that, other than family bonds that were created, we also created bonds with the churches and the family and the places that we went to. And when I first came to Cedar Grove a few years ago now, this felt like home. It didn't feel like I had come somewhere where we were going to go sing, we didn't know anybody, and we were kind of nervous whether they'd accept us or not. When I came here, I was home. I walked in the door and it was home. It felt just like where I'd grown up, just where if I played the wrong chord, nobody would know and nobody would care, because they didn't want to be up here anyway singing, so they were just happy about it. So if we can all just stand this morning, and we're going to sing through the family of God a couple times, because not only do we have opportunities to build time like that, we are already a family in God's eyes. So let's stand together. I believe, I have no idea where it's at. 393. I knew it was 300 something. 393. We'll sing that through a couple of times.
Well, we're done with that one. Don't sit down. Last one, don't go and forget. Just briefly, I'd like to read from Hebrews chapter 10. We celebrated 148 years of ministry as a church family. This is our encouragement for today. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have this boldness to enter into the sanctuary through the blood of Jesus Christ, he has inaugurated for us a new and living way through the curtain that is through his flesh. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance, and with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed in pure water. Let us hold to the confession of our hope without wavering, since he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider, dear brothers and sisters, one another in order to provoke to love and good works, not neglecting to gather together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging each other, and all the more as you see the day approaching. We are a family of God, and today we stand on the promises.
Verse 1. 339. Standing on the promises.
And you can't stand on the promises if you're sitting on the premises, so don't sit down. Downstairs that has been prepared. Bless the time of fellowship as we encourage and build each other up. Father, we look forward to the opportunities that we have before us to serve you. And when we consider the adversity and difficulty that we face, it is nothing in comparing to what you have for us, the glory and the hope and the beauty of eternal life in your presence in which we await. Father, to you be all glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' holy and precious name, all of God's children said,